Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Mustafa Haraki from the Lebanese American University in Beirut. In this video, I'm going to introduce the financial accounting course. Basically, this video covers chapters 1 and 2 in addition to some concepts that enhance our understanding to the importance of financial accounting and its economic role. To begin with, before we dive into the concepts of financial accounting, I'd like to introduce for new people, new to the business world, the definition of or the idea of public companies as compared to private companies. So basically, companies are usually they have two forms or two types: the private company, which is privately held or privately owned, and normally the number of owners is limited. This is the convention or the regular case. A private company can be a really big company, yet it is privately owned. It means that not anyone from the public can go and purchase a portion or a share in this company. On the other hand, public companies, they are, of course, from the name, publicly owned or held. Very large number of a big number of owners. Anyone can hold a share. Or in other words, buy a stock in that company. Those such companies, they are publicly traded in stock exchanges. So when you go, for example, now online and you type in Samsung stock price or Apple stock price, for example, you would see the stock price and it's moving over time, and you see that those companies are being traded on NASDAQ or New York Stock Exchange or American Stock Exchange or whatever. So they are publicly available to the to everyone, to owners, potential owners or potential investors. Those potential investors or actual or current investors can be either individuals, just regular people, or they can be also institutions. And when we say institutions, so I'm talking now about owners or investors, individuals, and institutions. And usually when we say institutions, we're talking about banks, hedge funds, investment funds, and so on and so forth. Before I move to the economic role of financial accounting, I'd like to introduce a simple concept where investors are usually referred to as equity investors. And when we say equity investors, we are talking about people who buy stocks in the company, so they own a share or a portion in this company. And when we say that a bank lends money to a company, the bank now is called a creditor. Creditors. So they lend money or funds to corporations. Of course, for the interest in return, corporations. Okay, so companies are public and private. We introduced the difference between those. Investors, when we say investors, we refer to equity investors usually, and equity investors are those who buy stocks or shares in a company. So when we say investors, we are talking about shareholders, so they hold shares in some corporation, shareholders or stockholders or owners. And those four terms, which refer to the same concept, They can be individuals or institutions, individuals just like any one of us, institutions just like a bank or a hedge fund or investment fund. On the other hand, we have those who invest in debt. We call them creditors. They lend money to the corporation. So they don't own a share in the corporation. However, they lend money to the corporation for the interest expenses that they receive. So this is basically the difference between private and public companies, in addition to some concepts that we will use throughout the explanation of the remaining concepts. The other thing I wanted to introduce before we start with the economic role of financial accounting is the structure of the company. So the company, basically, it's owned by shareholders. So shareholders or owners or equity investors or investors only, it's the same, or stockholders. So all these four terms are the same. Those people elect the board of directors that governs the corporation. So it's like the parliament that is being elected by the public. It's very similar to the to this system. So the public elects the parliament. The board of directors also elect or assign the chief executive officer or the CEO, who is the big boss of the company. He is the number one in the company. And then this guy assigns, of course, with the approval of the board, he assigns number two in the company, who is the chief financial officer or the CFO. And when we say chief financial officer or CFO, we're talking about a guy who masters accounting and finance, and he's like the, or she's like the black box of the company. They know everything about the company's financial position, structure, risks, and so on and so forth. So this guy is a very important or a key manager. And for this guy to be successful, he or she needs to know accounting. And this is the importance of learning accounting in the business world. Okay, now I'll move on to introducing the economic role of financial accounting. So as we said, we have the public, which are individuals, any individual, and institutions. So institutions, they will have different, okay? So individuals and institutions. And those people, individuals and institutions, want to invest their money in the economy. This economy, a better technical term for it, we call it the capital market. Okay? So they want to invest their money in corporations. And of course, when you invest your money in a corporation, it's basically saying that you are giving your money to the corporation, and in return, you're taking a share or shares. So you're becoming an owner in these corporations. Assume that this economy has three industries. Okay, the first industry is the consumables. The other industry is the services. And the third industry is construction. Okay, of course, we have much more variety of industries, but Just an example. Okay, so this is the industry. This is 1, 2, and 3. In each of these three industries, we have three ranks or three types of companies. So call them A, B, and C. Okay? In the services, we also have A, B, and C. And in construction, we also have A, B, and C. A, in each industry, is a group of companies. So each one of these group of corporations or companies. A is a very well-established company. It's performing really well. It's generating a profit and it's investing its funds or shareholders' funds in a very wise way. B is an okay company. They are doing well. Not as good as A, yet they are investing properly. They are taking profitable projects. Maybe they are not as good as A in managing the risk, but they are doing okay. C is a bad company. They are wasting the funds of the investors, and they are making losses for a long period. They have been making losses for a long period of time. Now, of course, the public, which comprises individuals and institutions, want to invest their money in the best companies in each industry. So they want their money to reach A, and if not A, at least B, but definitely not C. How would the public know that this group of people is ranked A? They are not labeled. There is no company. There isn't a company that has a label with I'm an A company. I'm a very good investor. I'm a very well-governed company that's performing well and I'm not making losses. No, it's not the case. So you will not see a billboard in front of the company saying, hey, this is a very bad company. Every company will do a window dressing for itself. So they will try to show themselves as the best company in the industry so that they attract investors and it attract investors' funds. Those people, the public, in order to make an economic decision where to invest in which group of people or in which companies to invest in each industry, they need something that shows the performance of those companies. What shows the performance of the companies, so the public needs something that shows the financial performance of the companies in a given industry. Of course, not only financial performance, in addition to investing opportunities, because we don't only care about the current time, we also care about the future. So investing opportunities. Okay? This thing that I'm talking about, therefore, the law obliges all public companies to report their financial statements to the public. Those financial statements tell the public about financial performance and other information that help investors make better investing decisions, right? So now if you know more about the company and about its financial performance and its investment opportunities, you can make a better financial position and know where to invest your money. So automatically, when we have a transparent and trustworthy financial statements reported by all companies in a given industry, those individuals and institutions which are the public, which are potential investors, will automatically or naturally and rationally invest their money in A's and B's in each industry, in A's and B's, right? When you invest money in A and B, automatically you're giving the nation's wealth, so the nation's wealth, therefore the nation's wealth is being invested in good companies that are expected to make profit or profits and grow automatically. Therefore, the whole economy will prosper. So in other words, and in one sentence, when financial reporting and financial accounting, which is basically the science of preparing or the art of preparing financial statements, is being done properly, those financial statements will aid the public to make a better investing decisions or better investing decisions, and therefore in this way financial accounting or financial reporting will be enhancing or improving the method or the or facilitates economic prosperity. So let me write it in one sentence, and this will be the bottom line of this explanation. I would say when financial reporting, and between parentheses accounting, is transparent and therefore, or accordingly, financial statements or financial reports, if you want, reflect the underlying financial performance of public corporations. So when financial reporting or accounting is transparent and therefore financial statements or reports reflect the underlying financial performance of corporations, investors, which is the public, will be able to make better investing decisions and therefore financial accounting facilitates economic prosperity because the nation's wealth is being invested in the right place. And automatically, in this way, when the funds of the nation goes to the good companies, the bad companies will go out of business because they will run out of funds. And this is how the whole economy will become a better place or a better capital market. Now, given that we introduced the economic role of financial reporting and accounting, let me now start with the main financial statements. So the main financial statements, and when we say financial statements, we're talking about the product that we as financial accountants produce. So when we do our job, we are preparing financial statements. We have three main financial statements. The first financial statement is called the balance sheet, and also it's also called a statement of financial position or a statement of financial position. The other statement is called the income statement, also it's called profit and loss statement. Finally, we have the statement of cash flows. Let me first begin with the balance sheet. The balance sheet tells me what the company owns and owes. In other words, it reflects, the statement reflects the financial structure of the company. The income statement, it tells me whether the company is being profitable, In other words, it reflects the financial performance of the company. Finally, the statement of cash flows. In the statement of cash flows, we trace cash, only cash, cash inflows and outflows from three activities: operating activities, financing activities, and finally investing activities. The state of cash flows will be covered in depth later on, but let me give you quick examples. When we talk about operating activities, we're talking about day-to-day operations. So if you pay a salary for an employee, this is a cash outflow from operating activities. When you make a sale, this is on spot and get paid on spot. It means that there's a cash inflow from operating activities. A financing activity example is when you take a loan. This is a cash inflow. Although the loan is a liability, yet it is an inflow of cash to the company. An investing activity, when a company acquires another company or acquires a land or a parking lot, for example, we are paying some cash, so this is a cash outflow from investing activities. Now our focus is the balance sheet and the income statement. As for the statement of cash flows, we will go and explain in depth about it in later chapters. So the balance sheet. In the balance sheet, The balance sheet has the following format. We always start with the company's name. Let's say we have XYZ Incorporation. Then the title of the balance of the financial statement, which is the balance sheet. When we say financial statement, it's simply a table that reports some financial information about the company. So this financial statement can be a balance sheet, an income statement, statement of cash flows, or other financial statements that we will see later on in the course. So XYZ Incorporation, balance sheet, and then in the balance sheet, we deal with the date on a specific day. This is a very important piece of information. So we say as at or as of, let's say the 30th of June 2020. Okay, so there's a specific date. Specific date. Or it's like a screenshot or a snapshot in time. Okay, like a screenshot. This balance sheet has three factors or three categories. The first category is called assets. And those are the resources of the company. Resources of the company. Or what the company owns. It also has liabilities. And these are the financial obligations. Of the company, so they need to pay them back to the creditors. And lastly, we have owners' equity. And when we say owners' equity, we're talking about the initial contribution of investors. Okay? Now, before we do this, before explaining the items under each of these three categories, I need to introduce the accounting equation. The accounting equation is very simple. It says that assets is equal to liabilities plus owners' equity. Okay, or owners' equity. Let me give you an example about this. If you decided to, you and your friends decided to establish a public company by investing $50,000 of this company, this means that your owner's equity is $50,000. Okay? This is your initial contribution in this corporation, $50,000. You realize that these $50,000 are not enough for the company to start up properly, so you needed additional $30,000. You go to the bank and apply for a loan and get a loan of $30,000. So your liabilities, you now owe the bank $30,000. In total, your economic resources that you can operate with are $80,000. So assets, the economic resources of the company, are equal to liabilities and owner's equity. Okay, our initial contribution, our liabilities to the bank or other creditors who can be individuals, and are equal to the assets or the economic resources of the company. Now, assets are everything owned by the company, whether they come from liabilities or from owner's equity. Assets include cash, which is the most basic form of any economic resource. They include cash. They include something called receivables. When we say receivables, it means that we made a sale, yet the customer did not pay us on spot. They told us that we will pay you later on, in 1 month, in 2 months, or whatever. This is very frequent when it comes to the business-to-business transactions. Businesses between each other, they don't pay on spot. They pay after a while. For you, if you made the sale, so you're expecting money from someone, they are called receivables. If those receivables are expected to be received without any interest terms, they are called account receivables. So if you are expecting to get paid after like 1 month without any interest, any additional interest on top of the principal value of the inventory that you sold or the good that you sold, it's called an account receivable. If you made a sale and the customer promised you to pay after 1 month, however, you wanted an interest for waiting for 1 month, then it will be called a note receivable. So the difference between those two receivables, in concept they are the same, the difference is that a note receivable is an interest-bearing receivable, okay? So both are called receivables. So cash, account receivable, note receivable, you own these things. You might have inventory. Inventory or inventory are the goods to be sold. Okay? So if you are an IT company or a high-tech company and you have some laptops, those are your inventory that you will be selling over time. Also, you might have office equipment or equipment in general. You might have vehicles, a truck for delivery, for example. You might have supplies. Those supplies can be anything that supports your operations. They can be cleaning supplies. They can be fuel supplies, anything. And then you have something like a building, for example, and a land. And of course, we have several other types of assets, but this is just to give you an idea about how a balance sheet looks like and what it should, or what to expect the balance sheet to include. All of those items are owned by the company. So those are the economic resources that the company uses in its operations to generate profits. Those assets, all of them, could be acquired by the company from the initial contribution of investors, which is owner's equity, or maybe from some debts or loans received by the company. One last thing I want to mention about assets. When we list them in the descending order of liquidity. Descending order of liquidity. So this is high liquidity, and this is low liquidity. When we say liquidity, it's the ease of converting an asset into cash. It's the ease of converting an asset into cash. So cash is the most liquid asset. It's already cash. Receivables are usually received within a short period of time, and they are expected to be converted into cash easily. Inventory are the first thing that you sell, so they are expected to be converted into cash. And all the way down to the least liquid items, which are the building and the land. Okay. Now, moving to liabilities. Liabilities, just like we have receivables over here, and you are expecting cash to receive cash from some customer, you might also purchase some goods or inventory from a supplier, and you promise the supplier to pay after a while. Therefore, now, instead of having receivables, you are liable to the supplier, and this liability is called a payable. If you will pay the supplier after like 1 month without any interest expense, then it's called an account payable. If the supplier had the condition that if you want to pay after a while, I'm fine with that. However, you need to pay an interest expense. Therefore, it will become a note payable. Also, you can have a salary payable. For example, the month is over and your employee deserves to be paid a salary for that month, and yet you haven't paid it. So it's a salary payable. For example, the government requires you to pay some taxes and you haven't paid your taxes, it's a tax payable. So liabilities can be anything that to be paid, anything to be paid. We also have something like a bank loan. And usually we call this as long-term debt because usually bank loans are paid over more than 1 year. So how to rank or list liabilities? We list them by the descending order of maturity. When we say maturity, so this is the least mature liability, and this is the most mature. Sorry, I flipped them. This is the most mature. So the descending order of maturity. Accounts payable are to be paid within like 1 month. Notes, something similar. Salaries, taxes. However, the bank loan will be paid over a long period of time, so it's the least mature. So the liability that will be paid sooner should be on the top, and the liability that will be paid later on should be at the bottom of the list of liabilities. As for owner's equity, we have two main items under owner's equity. The initial contribution of investors, we call them capital stock. Capital stock. So this is the initial contribution of investors. And also, if they add cash to the business after some time because they want to expand their operations, this number will increase as well. So capital stock. And we also have something called retained earnings. So it's the earnings that are being retained, and this is basically the accumulation of profits over time, over years or over time, it doesn't matter. So the accumulation of profit over time. So if in the first year you made $50,000 of profit, you will have 50,000. In the next year you have $25,000 of profit, this number will become 75,000, which is the 50,000 plus the 25,000 of year two profits. So this is how the balance sheet looks like. Those are the main items that you will see in a balance sheet and how they should be listed. Moving forward to the income statement. So this is the second one, the income statement, the second financial the financial statement, the income statement. The income statement, in its simplest form, we have two basic formats of the income statements. One for a merchandising company, and one for a service company. When we say merchandising company, it's a company that has some inventory and goods and they trade. So they sell inventory or goods. When we say a service company, so an example for a merchandising company is Walmart or any supermarket. They have goods and they sell them, make some profit, and that's it. A service company is like a hospital or a law firm or a hotel. They don't sell a tangible good, they sell a service. The service company, the income statement of the service company, of course, we start with the title XYZ Incorporation, the income statement. Remember that the income statement, it shows the profit or loss made by a specific company. The income statement has an interval of time. So what profit have the company generated from the beginning of Jan 2020 till the end of June 2020? So a sheet which has a specific date. So the balance sheet refers to one day only. The income statement covers an interval of time. So we would say from the beginning of Jan 2022 or till the end of June 2020. Okay? It's a very simple income statement. It starts with service revenue. When we say revenue, it's the income earned by the company for providing services. Just like when you pay the hotel to stay for one night there, this payment received by the hotel is a service revenue minus all expenses, or simply expenses. Of course, the hotel has a lot of expenses, salaries expenses for the maids and the receptionist. They have electricity or utility expenses. They have rent expenses. They have a big list of expenses. When you deduct all expenses from service revenues, you will get the figure that is called net income. And this net income is the profit or loss generated by a company. In the case of a merchandising company, the story is a bit more complicated because you have goods. So also you will have the title of the, or the name of the company, the title of the financial statement, so income statement, and we also have a range or interval of time from the beginning of Jan 2020 to the end of 6/2020. The starting point is not service revenues, it's sales revenues, because you are selling inventory or goods, minus, before deducting expenses, you need to deduct the cost of the goods that were sold. So cost of goods sold. You will see this COGS a lot throughout the semester and later on in accounting courses. When you deduct the cost of goods sold from sales revenue, you will get gross profit. Then this gross profit, when you remove from it other expenses, those expenses are also a long list of expenses, just like the service company. You might have salaries expense, interest expense, tax expense, depreciation expense. There is a long list that you will be familiar with in coming chapters. You will reach net income. Okay, so you will reach the same figure, net income. Now, what I want to say is that this net income that is generated by a company goes in two ways. It's either retained inside the company, so kept inside the company, or distributed among shareholders, so the owners of the company. So the chief financial officer or the CFO decides how much in percentage out of the net income to keep inside the company and to distribute over among shareholders. So the net income might be 40% of the net income distributed among shareholders and 60% of the company kept inside the company if the company wants to expand, if they want to get into a new business, if they want to keep some funds for unseen circumstances, and a long list of causes why to keep money or cash or income inside the company. When the money is kept or the income is kept inside the company, we call them retained earnings. And of course, you've seen this somewhere else, and I'll get back to it. If the income or earnings are distributed among shareholders, we call them dividends. This term comes from the term divide. So when you divide among shareholders, you are distributing a specific bulk of money among shareholders. So dividends is when you distribute some portion of your income, of the income of the company, among shareholders. The concept here is very simple. Assume that these 40% are just like, okay, let's say $400,000. So now you can tell that net income is $1 million. Distributed among all shareholders. The number of shares in this company is 1 million shares. A very simple example. 1 million shares. So each share will receive $0.4. So $0.4 per share. If Sam owns 100 shares in XYZ company, therefore Sam will receive 100 multiplied by $0.4. This is a $40 of dividends. Okay, now we're done with dividends. As for retained earnings, retained earnings, we've seen it before in the balance sheet. And the balance sheet, let me find, yeah, this is the balance sheet. This is the balance sheet that we prepared, and we saw that under owner's equity, we have two items. This is one and this is two. The second item is retained earnings, and we said that it's the accumulation of profits over years. So every time, or at the end of each financial cycle, when we prepare the income statement and get net income, we distribute some of the net income among shareholders. Whatever is left is kept inside the company, and this, or retained inside the company. From the term retained, it's kept inside the company. Those retained earnings are added to the figure that shows under owner's equity. It's the accumulation of profit over years. So as the company makes more profits, as this figure will be bigger in value. So the owner's equity is bigger, and therefore the company is growing and expanding. So this is the link, this figure here, is the link between the income statement and the balance sheet. This is the link, it links balance sheet to the income statement. Okay, retained earnings. As for the statement of cash flows, which I said that it will be covered later on in more depth, the link between the balance sheet and the statement of cash flows is this cash figure. The statement of cash flows shows all inflows and outflows that resulted in the cash account that is shown over here. Of course, inflows and outflows from the three activities, operating, financing, and investing activities. And this figure over here is the link between the balance sheet and the statement of cash flows. So you are expected to understand how each financial statement is structured, how to build it, and how the three financial statements are linked to each other. The cash flow statement and the income statement cover an interval of time from the beginning of Jan till the end of June. However, the balance sheet covers only one day. It's a snapshot in time. Here I said it's the end of June 2020. So the addition to this retained earnings figure is apparently, or basically, the retained earnings from this income statement, which covers from the beginning of Jan till the end of June. I'll see you with a new chapter. Thank you.